Green Business Certified, proudly made in America, Anoush Botanicals and Organics, personal care for you, your home, pets, and babies too.
Native California Garden, California Garden of Nature. And you look around, and it's laid out, so the center part represents the California grasslands, Central Valley. So you see some ceanothus, the purple blue flowers, the California native poppies, one of them, the orange poppy, and the Douglas irises. We have a hell of a time with the Douglas irises because the gophers love them. The grassland, and on this side is the chaparral, which continues on up to that hill. A lot of the ceanothus is there. Also, the
manzanita.
Thank you. The manzanita plants are here in addition, and many of these manzanitas were selected from areas that are warmer. And these plants don't like it here because it's not warm enough. So as time goes on, we're replacing the manzanitas with the appropriate ones. But we have in the garden, I think over there someplace, that Manzanita franciscanum, the native California, San Francisco, one that was found in the Presidio. We have it there. Our curator, Don Coney, helped identify that one. So we have that here. Trying to have the appropriate manzanita here. And I always love to think of manzanita, a little apple. This is the focal point for our children's education program. Because we can focus on the life and the situation of California youth here. And so we show how they the flour made from the horse chestnut. But the horse chestnut has a neurotoxin. So what has to be done is it has to be leached out. So they would grind the horse chestnut and then put hot water over that. Leached in sand, they would pick that up dry. But they would also use the fruit of the horse chestnut, crush it and put it in the water. That would stun the trout and they could just pick them out and they could have them for their lunch. So
this is a wonderful place to do a lot of that education. And over there it is a tree, the red elm, alder, red alder, whose leaves and stems, when crushed, turn red. And so we can bring out to the kids that when they needed to do the tattoos, they would chew the red alder and get the pigment from that and use that for tattoos. They would burn poison oak and use that as the black dye for there. And so here you see the streams through the grassland with the meadow foam in there, the five spots. And over time, this is really a nice place to come to just see the seasons transition through. $200,000 to John McLaren to establish or to help pay for the Botanic Garden. We used a little bit over time to design the Botanic Garden, and the last of it was used in about 1965. So her bequest of $200,000 was principal for this. But Willie Brown used to call this the scribbling arboretum, and we said we need to do something about that. So we said, let's call it what it is, the San Francisco Botanic Garden. But it's the San Francisco Botanic Garden at Scribing Arboretum. So we keep all of that. Helene Scribing, very interesting woman. She simply respected John McLaren very, very highly. Her husband was a wholesaler, a broker of fruits and vegetables, and they did quite well. They had no children. They were Swiss. And so she said, as she, this was left to her, let me give this to the city of San Francisco. So it's right in the room. Okay, let's go that way. You can't see everything nor tell all the stories, but you've heard enough from me. Sorry, I hope I haven't gone on too long. This, we won't be able to go through here, but this is the Mesoamerican cloud forest. Mesoamerican, Middle or Central American cloud forest. Why cloud forest? 6 to 10,000 feet in elevation. Annual rainfall, 100 to 200 inches. So, Dr. Dennis Breedlove, a botanist over at the Academy, began collecting seeds from Mexico in probably 1965-69, all the way up until the early 80s. He collected a lot of seeds and said, okay, now we can get a Mesoamerican cloud forest going. Well, he said, let's get it going at UC Bot, at UC Botanical Gardens. So they started and they plant the section there. But it was soon learned that the cold of the winter in Berkeley was not tolerated by this group of plants. So they kept some that were tolerant to that and brought many here. So we now have two Mesoamerican cloud forests, one slightly less cold tolerant in Berkeley and the other one here. 6 to 10,000 feet, and the big plants that you see over there are in the daisy family. Now, the fact is that in that kind of a climate, so much rain, so inducive of growth and germination, that everything would grow, but it tends to grow up so high that it cuts off the light for plants. And so over time and over the millennia, the plants, the daisy plants, the Asteraceae, have increased in height. And so you'll see that many, you see a magnolia over there. That's Magnolia de Albata. The other one, the Chinese one, is Baby Doctor. This is de Albata. Huge leaves, deciduous. And the accommodation is to the darkness of that forest for the magnolia group. But the magnolias are there. So we see magnolias in Central and along the Andes, Central America, along the Andes, Mexico. We see in China, Indonesia, Japan, East Africa, interestingly enough, and Southeast region of the United States. So that's the story of these. You don't have time to go in. Another time when you come, particularly October, November, and so forth, come through here and see the wonderful collection of like that maple. Now, the Asian maple, the Japanese maple, we've seen California maple, and we see the Central American maple. So really quite broadly dispersed too. And then the daisies, and then there are other very specific plants that are found only in that area, like the Cupaea, that orange plant. Cupaea. Yes, ma'am.
What about
that tree behind? That's a pine, and the interesting thing about that, look at it. And notice at the bottom of the growth buds, there are all those cones. What are they? Male or female? They're the male cones. This plant is pollinated by wind, essentially, or that's the mechanism. The female cones are very small near the growth buds up high in the tree. So it's always interesting to me why The male cones are below and the female cones are above, but that's the way it goes. I guess the wind sort of sweeps up in that way and they're protected together. But this is Pinus Oaxacana, so from Oaxaca. Okay, the last story. These are the dawn redwoods. So we've seen the California redwoods, but these are their grandparents. Where do they come from? China. So this has a very long botanic name, and I'll just leave you with the dawn redwoods. They were in Temple Garden also, as we saw some of the magnolias in Temple Garden. And in 1947, some botanists in China wrote an article for the botanic literature saying, you in the West think that these are just in the fossil rest, but that isn't so. They're growing in our Temple Garden. So some faculty from UCSF and Berkeley went over to China in 47, before the revolution. And they got the seeds and brought them back and planted. They grew beautifully in the Bay Area. So this is the dawn redwood. They are deciduous. The cones look very much like the Sierra redwoods, like the Sequoia sempervirens, like we saw the coastal redwoods and the others. And the last bit of the story is during the Cultural Revolution, there were many of these in Beijing. And so the leaders said, we want to get rid of the past, take all the dawn redwoods down. And they were taken down. I was there in, 1996, and they were now replanting the dawn redwoods in Beijing. They're wonderful trees. They grow very, very well. But you can't have a small backyard. You got to have a big yard for these. Okay. So we're back to the Monterey cypresses and then the dawn redwoods.